100 years ago, Georgia was a good place to build a cotton or a textile mill. Put a mill near the cotton fields, then it costs less to get the cotton from the fields to the factory. What's more, people in Georgia often worked for less than Northerners did. Factory owners liked that because it meant more money for them. Unions tried for years to get the mill owners to treat their workers better. And when the owners didn't listen, sometimes the workers went out on strike. That's what happened in 1914 at Atlanta's huge Fulton bag and cotton mills. Today, these cavernous buildings are empty. The machinery went silent a long time ago. Back in 1914, though, the Fulton bag and cotton mills were among the largest in the South. More than 1,300 people made cotton bags here for flour and sugar and other foods that had to be packaged for shipping. Many of these textile workers used to live on family farms in North Georgia, but times were tough and some lost their farms, so they came to the city to make money. But working in a factory was dirty and noisy, back-breaking work for these men and women and children. They were used to hard work on the farm, but not this repetitive, monotonous shift work. They felt like a part of the machines they worked with.
The amount of hours that they spent in very hard labor was just incredible. It was 60 and 70 hours a week, and there wasn't a lot of time after that to do much of anything else.
On the farm, they were independent. They did what needed to be done when they were ready to do it. In the factory, someone else told them how to work and when and for how long. They felt cut off from their roots in the country, from the land, from their past.
Workers, in many cases, people who'd come off the farm, who'd been used to running their own lives, were simply not accustomed to having someone standing over them and telling them every minute, you're going to do this, and then you're going to do this, and then this, any more than any of the rest of us.
The mill owners thought they were more progressive than most. They paid above average wages. They built houses near the factory for their workers and charged low rents. The owners even opened a dining hall, offering good food at low prices. But the workers stayed away.
Workers, by and large, chose to eat by themselves, and only a very small minority of the workers here ever actually took advantage of that. They thought that lunchtime was their own time, and they didn't want to be monitored so carefully by the company.
The list of grievances against the company grew over the years. A big complaint was how difficult it was to breathe while working here. The heat and the cotton dust were choking. And the Fulton bag mill workers hated this man, the company doctor. When he visited a worker's home because someone was sick and missed work, workers thought of it as spying. Privacy wasn't their only concern. The workers also thought there were just too many company rules, too many people ordering them around.
For the loom fixers, who are among the most skilled workers, they had to leave a dollar deposit on whether there was any defective cloth when they left, and it was only after it was inspected that they might get their dollar back.
But managers often kept that dollar. When people made only $8 or $10 a week, $1 was a lot of money to lose. By May 1914, workers at the Fulton Bag and Cotton Mills had had enough of long hours, unfair work rules, and management constantly pushing them to do more for the same wages. They also didn't like their children having to work in the mill. Kids 8, 10, 12 years old worked as many as 12 hours a day in the mill, and that work was hot, dangerous, and exhausting, especially for a child. So in May 1914, about 500 of the 1,300 mill workers left their jobs and went out on strike, which was a risky thing to do.
At this time, there were no laws protecting workers who had organized and gone out on strike. They did not have a legal right to organize, in fact, as workers have had in America since the 1930s. And so workers who struck did so at their own risk.
Textile unions had such a history of losing in the South that when a worker who was absolutely dependent on their wage had to make the decision of whether to join a union and go on strike, they had to do this with the assumption that they were probably going to lose.
It was mostly a peaceful strike, even when the strikers saw the company hired new workers to replace them. And back then, these workers were easily replaced.
So many people were down and out, were destitute, in need of work, were impoverished, that they could relatively easily bring in new recruits to come in and work here.
The company also hired company spies who infiltrated the union by pretending to be union workers.
There was one spy in particular who began as a song leader, and he would lead the songs for the union, and he infiltrated all the way up to the top levels of the United Textile Workers, writing these reports back and really helping create division within different factions in the union.
The union fought back by taking pictures, despite interference from company detectives. Pictures of union members and their families evicted from company housing. Pictures of the tent city the union set up for the evicted families to live in. Pictures of the union commissary and dining tents where people were fed. The union used these pictures to gain support, to get people on their side.
They posted photographs in downtown drugstores here in Atlanta. They made some of the postcards, some of the photographs into postcards and sent them all over the country. They spoke in different kinds of organizations. They did a lot in sort of appealing to public opinion.
But the union just couldn't beat the powerful company. The mill was able to keep running the whole time during the strike with replacement workers. After less than a year, the strikers gave up and the strike died. Most of the 500 or so strikers were blacklisted by management and never worked at the Fulton Bag and Cotton Mills again.
Fiddlin' John Carson, known as the father of country music, worked at the Fulton Bag and Cotton Mills and took part in the strike.